Hello, B here, and welcome back to Integrated Physics and Chemistry. What do you think of this cool trick? It looks a little like magic. Do you think it really is magic? Is there no other explanation for things moving without being touched? Well, you might be a little disappointed to find out that no. Sadly, it's not magic at all, but it is science. Magnets are responsible for all sorts of phenomena that might seem like magic, though. In today's lesson, we'll look at the cold, hard facts of how they work and see that no magic is necessary, but they're still a bit mysterious, even to scientists. But before we get started, let's look at our goals for this lesson. By the end, you'll be able to explain how magnetic poles are created, explain what is necessary for a material to be magnetic, and compare and contrast the electromagnetic force with gravity. If you've spent any time playing with magnets, you probably know that they have a north and south pole. And you may even know that if you bring two north poles together, they will repel each other, as will two south poles. However, bringing a north pole near a south pole will cause the magnets to attract and pull toward one another. But have you ever wondered what would happen if you cut a magnet in half? Would one piece be the North Pole and one piece be the South Pole? No, that's not what happens at all. For a magnetic material, no matter how many times it is broken apart, it will always still have a North and South Pole. This is because materials are magnetic all the way down to the atomic level. So unless we're actually going to break the individual atoms apart, we won't be able to avoid having both poles. Does this seem like magic still? Let's look more closely at the atomic nature of magnetic materials to understand why it's actually explainable by science. We know from previous lessons that the electrons are responsible for electricity. When they flow, the moving charges create a current that produces energy. So it will probably come as no surprise that the electrons are responsible for magnetism as well. The electrons seem to have all of the interesting jobs in an atom. Electrons cause magnetism because in addition to orbiting the nucleus of an atom, they also have angular momentum, which generally arises from spin, just like the Earth spins as it orbits the sun. Scientists are still unsure whether electrons spin in the traditional sense that we are used to, but the direction of their angular momentum creates a north and south pole. So this property of electrons is referred to as their spin. We can think of electrons as being tiny magnets, the tiniest magnets possible. But all atoms have electrons, and we know that the atoms of most elements are not magnetic. Iron atoms most definitely are, though. Let's look at the structure of an iron atom. From our lesson on atomic structure and valence electrons earlier in the course, you may remember that the electrons arrange themselves on energy levels around the nucleus. Notice in this atom of iron, most of the electrons are paired up, but a few electrons don't have a buddy. They are on their own. When electrons pair up, they always spin in opposite directions, so their north and south poles cancel out, so that there is no net magnetic force. But lone electrons always spin in the same direction, so their poles are always aligned in the same way. If we imagine an iron atom with lots of tiny magnets as electrons, it would look like this. There is no resulting magnetic force from the paired electrons, so we can ignore those, but its four unpaired electrons do create a net magnetic force in one direction, causing iron to be magnetic. Sorry, aspiring magicians, but so far, science is wrapping this mystery up pretty well. Well, We've almost solved the mystery of magnetism, but there's still one problem. See this piece of foil? It's made of aluminum, which does have an unpaired electron. So, should my magnet be attracted to it? Apparently not. Even though its atoms have unpaired electrons, aluminum is not magnetic. This is because having magnetic atoms does not make an entire material magnetic. If the atoms are arranged randomly, with the magnetic poles of the atoms pointing all different directions, the magnetic poles will cancel each other out, just like the magnetic poles of two neighboring electrons cancel out. In some materials, like iron and nickel, the atoms arrange themselves such that their poles are all pointing the same direction, creating what is known as a domain. But domains are still microscopic, and even a small piece of material may have many domains, and there's no guarantee all of the domains will be aligned. This material would still not be magnetized. But in the presence of a magnetic field, the domains of some materials may line up such that every single one faces the same way. And now we finally have a magnet. But this is why most materials are not magnetic. It takes a lot of details being just right in order for everything to line up in such a way that a net magnetic force emerges. So, why do some materials create magnetized domains while others don't, even when their individual atoms have magnetic poles? This is where it might really feel like magic. Science can explain it, but unfortunately, it involves discussions about electron configurations and energy states that is beyond the scope of this course. So if you want to call it magic for now, I'll let you. But be warned, take a higher level chemistry course, and even this bit of magic will get smashed by science. We've discovered why materials are magnetic. The spin direction of unpaired electrons create a north and south pole. But this still doesn't explain why magnets behave the way they do. What causes metal objects to be attracted to a magnet, even against the pull of gravity? It turns out that gravity is a good comparison for the electromagnetic force. Just as two massive objects like the Sun and Earth experience a gravitational attraction, magnetized objects, such as a bar magnet and a pile of paper clips, experience an attraction as well. Both gravity and the electromagnetic force are non-contact forces because they can act over distances between objects that do not touch. This is because they both create a force field. We'll learn more about the electromagnetic force field in the next lesson. How do you think the gravitational and electromagnetic forces compare? Which one is stronger? The electromagnetic force is way stronger than the gravitational force. Does that surprise you? Think of it this way. You would never be able to feel the gravitational attraction between two small objects in your hands. But if those objects were magnetic, you would definitely feel the force pulling them together. The electromagnetic force is thought to be stronger than the gravitational force by a factor of 10 to the 36th. That's a lot of zeros! The gravitational force between the Earth and Sun is already large enough to keep Earth in orbit. Imagine if the Earth and Sun were both made entirely of magnetized iron. The electromagnetic force between them would be so strong that they would be stuck together like glue. As we went through the lesson today, we learned that magnets are not magic, just science. It all comes down to the electrons and their property of spin. Our magic trick turned out to be just the repulsion between two like poles of a magnet. Magnetic atoms are created when an electron has no neighboring electron to cancel out the magnetic pole that the spin generates. And if a bunch of neighboring atoms decide to line up their magnetic poles in the same direction, the material can exert a magnetic force on any object that enters its force field. In the lesson PDF activities, you'll look at the difference between temporary and permanent magnets, and find out how magnets can sometimes lose their magnetism. Next time, we'll explore this mysterious magnetic field in more depth. Until then, remember, the universe is vast and full of surprises, so never stop exploring. See you next time. Hey, hey.